Welcome to another edition of One on One with Mitch LaFon. We speak with the basis of White Zombie. Sean, we talk about the new box set. It came from New York City. Also, we talk about Tableau Vivant and Nature Morte. Yes, we speak art with her. So, hey, without further ado, here is the one, the only, Sean from White Zombie. We are speaking with Sean Usolt, formerly of White Zombie, the new box set as it came from New York, but there's also all kinds of photography and art and books and just a lot of interesting stuff to talk about. So, welcome.
Hi, thank you.
So let's just get started with the It Came From New York box set. I mean, this is the early stuff that, of course, Jay has remastered and stuff. What input did you have in the making of the box set?
I actually had quite a lot. I'm the one member that was in the band alongside Rob from, you know, day one to the day we broke up. And I was also a photographer, and I also saved everything. So Jay did a lot of pack ratting as far as flyers and things while he was in the band. But I've got all that stuff since day one, including the first T-shirt I screened for us, which I think I only made one for me and one for Rob. So they actually came, and the label Numero Group came down from Chicago and hung out for a few days going through all my items and took a lot of my T-shirts and photos and posters and flyers and you name it. I still have all the old records that are in this box that I still have originals in mint condition that they took to scan and use for record artwork. And
right.
Pretty much everything you see is either from my closet or Jay's, you know, as far as T-shirts and artwork and photos and things. So yeah, very, very involved.
Was it important for you to be involved in this one? Because I know Let Sleeping Corpses Lie, you were sort of left on the side, both of you. When they came around with the idea for this one, was it more like, hey, wait a minute, we need to be involved in this?
Yes, exactly. It was that was the main thing, because that first one that came out, it had no information. You could barely read even the credits. There's no liner notes, nothing. So, they definitely wanted to get our story and everyone's story. If you look at that 108-page booklet, the guy that wrote the story interviewed so many members of the band, and it's just amazing. I learned things reading. I didn't even know before Rob and I met that one of his roommates was in the Vatican Commandos. You know, that's
right.
You know, these are bands I used to see at CBGB, so that was cool. You know, it was just funny. I actually, reading what other band members wrote, I actually learned a few things myself. So that's crazy.
What was it like revisiting the music? Because I would imagine that you probably haven't heard some of these songs in 20 years. Does it bring back memories? And do you sit there now and go, oh, if I had only done this, how critical are you of that old stuff?
No, I'm never critical. Rob's a highly critical one. He never liked anything we did. So as soon as we made a 7-inch or any vinyl record that like is in this box set, he hated it immediately. And, we lived together. We were a couple. So he was like, oh, it's terrible. So it would go on the shelf and we couldn't listen to it. And I'm the opposite. I like just, hey, you know what? Be bold, go out there and make music. If it sucks or if it's not what you meant, you know, carry on and maybe you do better next time. But no, I have no, like, I don't listen to it going, oh, I wish, you know, we had gone to a different chord there, or wish we had re-recorded the solo there. No, I don't ever listen to things that way. It is what it is, you know?
Right.
It's not like amazing, but it's kind of incredible listening to it. I was kind of blown away. It's better than I thought it was.
Yeah,
we were doing something new, most importantly, which is what we were trying to do.
Yeah, definitely something artistic. Included in this set is God of Thunder, which came out in 89. As a Kiss fan myself, I heard about all these rumors about Gene and Simmons doing. What's the sort of the real story with that and you guys putting the makeup on the cover? Were you sued? Were you not sued? How much is
We were not sued, but and we actually met Gene about somewhere into that first year of that record coming out, and our future A&R guy at Geffen, Michael Lago, took Rob and I go see Kiss, and he took us backstage, and we met Gene and Paul, who were towering over us on their platforms, and we were really scared that he was going to be pissed off, and he was super nice, and I think he, you know, he knew it was pretty harmless, and, you know, maybe it kind of brought a little more attention to Kiss in a different world than he was in, so he was super nice about it, that's all I can say, I don't know where all those rumors started. I guess people just figured that Gene would sue us, so the rumors started. And
You haven't met many Kiss fans, right?
It was good for us. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
It got us some press.
Well, listen, it was, for me as a Kiss fan, it was the first time I had heard about your band, and I went, oh, well, who's this band that Gene's suing? And, you know, listen, that's how...
See? It worked.
It absolutely
did. We didn't start the rumor, but we were happy for it.
That's funny. You know, musically, what do you think the legacy of White Zombie is?
Well, I think one thing that everybody points out is that we were one of the first bands, not the only band, but one of the first bands that did really heavy music with a groove to it. So we kind of, you know, became a metal band, but we had a good groove to the music. And I'd say that's one thing. And also very early on, if you can hear it on this record, I think in Soul Crusher, Rob was like holding like an old 1970s cassette recorder up to the television and recording snippets of B-movies and all kinds of crazy things and sampling. And, you know, very prehistoric sampling days. But I think we were kind of the first, I don't know for a fact, but I think we were one of the first kind of noise/metal bands to, you know, kind of incorporate samples and odd things into our music.
Right, that new genre, noise metal, right?
Yeah, and I don't want to take credit for a whole lot of things, but also one thing we did that no one was doing at the time was we were determined to put on a show. Rob loved Kiss, and I loved theatrical things like Alice Cooper and, you know, all that. And we loved big rock shows, even though we were this weird kind of arty noise band on the Lower East Side. We loved all that. So even when we were playing CBGBs with Rat at Radar or Honeymoon Killers or any of these, you know, noise bands, we were like trying to, you know, we'd save up a little money and get a cop light, you know, like a siren, you know, put it on our amp, or we get a smoke machine, you know, and we'd always play a Kiss cover, you know, CBGBs every time. And I think people were just looking at us so confused. Yeah. What are they trying to do? But, you know, we were trying to put on a show, and we made sure we ran around and jumped around and didn't like shoegaze like a lot of the bands were doing back then. And I like to think that maybe we tried to bring back a little of that into bands that wasn't going on at the time.
Yeah, no, it certainly added a flavor to the rock show. You know, the band famously broke up, and Rob has said, well, it's run its course. When he decided to move on and be a solo artist, how did you react to that? Did you wish him well, or were you like, I hope it fails and he comes back to me in 2 years? And when I mean, honestly.
No, I didn't, first of all, I knew that we were breaking up. It wasn't a big surprise, but it was a little bit of a slap in the face to me and Jay when we had after 1 year, we're supposed to be taking a break, and then we're going to have a call and talk about getting back together to make a record. I knew that we weren't getting back together, but literally the next, you know, Jay and I both said we'd love to, you know, we have more riffs. We'd love to write some more music. And Rob kept saying, no, I think we're done. And, you know, what are you going to say? You can't tell the singer that he has to sing, you know? So even though our manager told Jay and I that we should go on and continue on with White Zombie and get a new singer, we both refused that. But the slap in the face was that his solo record came out like the next day. So he had spent that year making a record knowing that, you know,
that he was going to move on.
Going to be a band again. Yeah, so that was a little, you know,
yeah,
whatever.
But we're
like, who cares? You know,
right.
Really.
Well, okay, so
I didn't care. I moved to New Orleans. I knew that we'd already broke up anyway.
So let's talk about stuff that you do care about, and it's making these Tableaux Vivants and Nature Morte.
Ah, thank you. Yes, my new photo show.
Yeah, let's talk about that because I'm interested in sort of the aesthetic eye because, you know, a tableau vivant, for those that don't know, is basically you take people and you arrange them and, you know, I'm being very pedestrian in the way I'm describing it, but you put people in a picture and you sort of, you know, how do you decide what to capture and how you're going to place the people and what scenes you're going to put them in and just talk to me about that whole aesthetic.
Yeah, that so no, you described the tableau vivant perfectly. It is a big part of New Orleans where I've been living all these years. It goes the old Mardi Gras crews were secret societies to begin with, and they would stage these big elaborate parties in theaters, and they'd have on the stage these tableau vivants where, and it would be the first one for Comus, one of the biggest crews was Dante's Inferno. So there's like, you know, fake flames and millions of little devils all over the stage and all this stuff. I got really fascinated with it. And then I started kind of researching more about the secret societies, and it kind of tied in with Skull and Bones and all these kind of dark, sordid things, you know, that rich people do. And there was a lot of that going on in New Orleans. You know, there's a lot of money here and craziness. So I kind of based my show around that, around a party that these people had, and I created my own secret society named the Omniscient Oracles of the Occult. And what's hilarious is that so many people after my show started researching this group to find out more about them, and I was like, okay, I made them up. It's not real, but it's all based on stuff. So yeah, I just kind of my imagination just went kind of wild as far as some the events that would take place at this party. And you know, there's Skull and Bones has a ritual called the Killing of the Kings. There's a scene there where the king is already drinking absinthe in a coffin, and there's somebody behind him with a knife. And you know, it was just a lot of it was all a bit tongue in cheek. I love Edward Gorey, you know, so it had a bit of a Gorey-esque storytelling element to the whole show. But yeah, it's seven very large panels. I printed these photos 4 feet by 6 feet, and it's definitely it makes an impression.
Yeah, it really does. Where does sort of your photography eye stop? I mean, would we ever see you like, you know, in nature taking pictures of birds and coyotes, or are you really more interested in the human element?
Neither actually. I mean, neither in both. I love photographing animals and humans, but I don't love capturing things so much as creating things. I'll just wake up from a dream and write something down, but an image in my head, and then I'll draw it out, and then I'll stage it exactly as I saw it, you know. So those, like every photo in that show is actually a sketch first, and then I find the elements and the, you know, the models and put it all together. So yeah, it's you know,
Yeah.
a little more like that is what I'm kind of obsessed with.
And of
It's
course, you also do
staging.
the staging. Yeah, you also do the nature morte, which is basically staging, I don't want to say vegetation,
Still
but
life, still life.
it's. Right, so
Well,
just.
still life, and that. Well, actually, I last time I was in Paris, I noticed at the Louvre, like, all the still lifes are in French, it's nature morte. And I was like, oh my God, dead nature, you know, is like the direct translation to me.
Yes.
So I love that because I collect a lot of dead things. I have a lot of I have a lot of taxidermy and human skulls and all kinds of things. So I was like, perfect. That's the name of my show. And
Yeah.
yeah, I already had the things to photograph, so it kind of
Yeah.
worked out.
I had always been told that nature morte is basically the fruit basket on the table. It's a picture of that kind. That's how it was always explained to me, but you know.
No, you're correct. You're correct that it's also those gory, like Dutch masters where you have the bloody rabbit hanging off the edge of the table. You know? Like every once in a while, there's some dark element in there. So I like to play on that.
You also make soirée d'évolution books and stuff, very limited runs that you handcraft yourself. Talk to
Yes.
me about that because as you're handcrafting them, that means that essentially everyone is unique because you know, even if you put the same picture on the same page, it's there's always a little, you know,
Yeah.
Talk to me about the importance of doing those, and you know, basically, why have you gotten into doing that?
Well, because I did the books because each picture did have a little story I wrote with it. Sometimes just four poetic lines, sometimes a small paragraph, you know, with a little more historical background. But I'll tell you, I'll never do it again because it's really hard hand making books. It's really time consuming and stitching the pages and everything. It's just grueling work. And I have a lot of respect for bookmakers, and this is probably my first and last time I'll do this.
Right, right.
But they're beautiful, but oh my God. Yeah, a lot of work.
Absolutely a lot of work. And I do want to ask you a little bit more about the music, but I will finish with the art for now, with the Mississippi Mermaids. I thought that was fascinating, that imagery that you created. I know it's sort of silly to ask the question, but sort of where does that concept come from? How does that come to you?
That was one of those dreamlike visions in my head. I just kind of saw women floating in water inside of a bottle, you know, like a message in a bottle. And I couldn't, for the life of me, figure out how to do it for about 6 months. And then I just decided to start shooting the elements and playing around, and I finally figured it out. It's a trick. There's a trick. Just like getting the boat inside the little tiny bottle, there's a trick to it. But I figured it out, and it's the magician's secret, but I was very happy with the results. And yeah, I've got, I think, 13 different women in 13 different bottles and 13 different bodies of water, and it was a lot of fun doing this.
Yeah, it's visually stunning. Musically, where are you? You're welcome. Musically, where are you in your career? And I mean, I know after Zombie, you did some bands here and there, but where are you now in 2016? Have you thought of, you know, solo albums and bands and writing, and what are we doing?
Yes. I still play sometimes with my band Rock City Morgue down here in New Orleans. I love playing with these guys because the singer is like the Nick Cave meets Mick Jagger kind of crooner, and I play a lot of kind of dark blues piano, and it's really fun. But everyone in that band is kind of split off different ways, doing all kinds of different things. And then more recently, I've been playing in a band called Star and Dagger, and we're still together, but it's same thing. I mean, everyone's just, even our guitarist doesn't even live here. She lives in New York. So we still exist, and we have like 10 new songs we need to record. We just have not had time in like over a year to get together. So we are going to try to do that, but I've just been really busy with my photography, and everyone else is busy with their work and their interests. And it's definitely back burner, but it's fun for us, you know, and I love writing. And I also have been doing a little bit of like soundtrack kind of music and composing on keyboard again. And I love that. And I just got a whole new keyboard program set up, and I'm actually going to start on that next week again. So yeah, it's something that I'm always doing on and off. It's just, you know, I have to pay attention to certain areas of creativity in my life more than others at times.
Yeah, it seems like there's just an abundance of creativity now. Now, Star and Dagger, as far as I can remember, the last album or the only album was 2012. So that's already been 4 or 5 years, right?
Oh, has it been that long? Oh my goodness. We did an EP with a small label also, and I'm not even sure what the name of it. It might just be called In My Blood. It's that plus two other songs that are not on the album, but I can't even remember when that came out. Yeah, it's been a couple of years.
You're losing track with all this stuff. I want to ask you about I'm in the Band, the book that came out somewhere 2010, 2011. What was that like, putting that collection together and looking through? Cause, I mean, I guess you redid it on this new box set, but what was that like for you going and putting that book together?
That was really fun for the most part. So I just, you know, after Katrina, I started on that book around 2008. And after Katrina, we had a huge hole in our roof. You know, there was a lot of damage down here in New Orleans, and rain had come through the third floor down to the second floor, made another pool of water, and come down all the way through the kitchen on the first floor. And it had just missed my storage space on the third floor, and the, you know, and where I had all my White Zombie stuff. And I thought, Jesus, I need to like scan and document all these things. And I actually just started doing it for myself. I was going to make like a little iPhoto book, you know, and people saw what I was scanning and what I was up to. And they're like, you know, you should put this out for the fans. And I approached an agent and they wanted to rep me. And next thing you know, I had some book offers. And so, yeah, it was really fun doing it. And it was mostly just kind of a tribute to all my friends and all the bands we toured with and all the people that helped us. And, you know, if you look through it, there's pages where I let a lot of important people in White Zombie's life have their own page. I was like, you know, just said, write whatever you want to write. Like Daniel Ray, who kind of discovered us before we got signed to Geffen. He helped us, you know, attract a lot of major labels. And he took us, you know, to make our last record on Caroline, the God of Thunder record. Or like Steve Blush, who had See Here Records and put on a bunch of cool like underground shows in the East Village. So I just told people like, hey, you know, just write whatever you want to write. It could be good, bad, whatever you want about White Zombie. And so it was really fun just kind of collaging all that together. I actually got to design the book, and you know, I kind of was going for a scrapbook look. So I had so many things from backstage passes and tickets and flyers and posters and, you know, clothes that I designed that I had people make for me. Just crazy stuff. So it was fun, you know, putting that together.
Yeah, it was a great book. Is there a second one in you, or do you have more sort of in that storage space?
No, that was it. I mean, honestly, when Numero Group came down for this vinyl box set, I was like, you know, I used most of the good stuff already in my book, but we can take a look, you know? So they did manage to dig up a number of other things, but you know, now I think it's, you know, it's down to the dregs now. Yeah, I think everybody's seen all the good stuff between the book and the box set.
There's nothing left. Now I was told we had 20 minutes and we have passed that, but I'll finish with this though. Do you have closure on White Zombie, or does it take one last show or one last something, or can you walk away and say, okay, I got it. Rob doesn't want to do this. We're done. We're done. And everybody's happy.
Oh yeah. No, I mean, we're done. I have closure as far as that goes.
Okay.
It would be so much more pleasant if, you know, he would communicate with us. I mean, we're all in the band together, you know, dated for 7 years. It's just kind of weird to have somebody disappear out of your life, like, you know, clean slice like that. But, you know, that's his choice. I mean,
right. But do you know why? Was there a lawsuit with Geffen? Was there?
No, there was nothing. He just felt that he needed
space.
Solo and, okay. No, there was nothing like that. I mean, he and I were a couple and broke up, and I'm sure that didn't help. But
right.
You know, but, otherwise it was, you know, there wasn't really bad blood. We still got along fine.
It is what it is, and now we've got the It Came From New York box set, so of course fans can enjoy that. Sean, it's been an absolute pleasure, and it's not very often that we get to talk about Tableau Vivant and Nature Morte during rock interviews, so that's great.
I really appreciate it. I enjoyed the interview. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sean, and this will be up next week for the world to enjoy.
Great. I'll look for it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
All right, take care.
Bye-bye. And there you have it, folks, my interview with Sean, former bass player for White Zombie. The new box set is It Came From NYC. It's not very often that you get to talk about Tableau Vivant and Nature Morte during a rock interview, but there you go. We did, and so I hope you enjoyed that. Please check me out at Mitch LaFon, MitchLaFon, on Twitter, and one-on-one Mitch LaFon on the Facebook page. There you go. Thank you, folks. Bye for now. Oh my.